God. I am blessed to be in the house of the Lord today. Can we forego my song?
Amen.
I let me tell you, God, I have what I need to preach. The time is far spent. but you know what? I made a promise to them and I was singing. So I'm gonna sing. I wanna say Sister Thompson gave me a sermon to preach. Well, a sermon. Right, not Sister Thompson, the committee. But the Lord led me in a different direction. And I really want to get to that today. Let's go ahead and cue up the song. I pray that you're blessed.
Jesus steps up.
Maturity, she has only about 400,000 eggs remaining. Only about 400 will ever mature. Sperm production in a man begins around 12 to 13 years of age. The daily average for sperm cells production is 85 million. This means that a single male may produce more than a quadrillion sperm in his lifetime. But out of these millions came you and I. It took a miracle to get who you are. That's why Jeremiah declares in Jeremiah chapter 1:5, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet to the nations. God saw you. God saw me. That's why the psalmist declares, I will praise you. For I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. My substance was not hid from thee when I was made in secret, and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Thine eyes did see my substance, yet being unperfect, and in thy book all my members were written, which in continuance were fashioned, when as yet there was none of them. How precious also are thy thoughts unto me, O God. How great is the sum of them. You're not an accident. Somebody needed to hear that today. Your life is not an accident. You're not an accident. And today we're going to look at a portion of a parable, the prodigal son, and see how just much you matter to God this morning. You turn your Bibles with me to Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15, verse 1 through 3. Then we're going to look at verses 11 through 17. Luke chapter 15, verse 1 through 3. Then we're going to look at verses 11 through 17. Are you there? Let's stand. The Bible, the Word of God declares that he then drew near unto him all the publicans, tax collectors, and sinners, for to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, this man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. And he spake this parable unto them, saying, and he said, verse 11, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that followed to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country. And there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would have fain have filled his belly, and he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger. I want you to pray with me as we spend a couple of moments to look at the title this morning, Lord, I'm Coming Home. Let's pray. Father in heaven, there's no accident with you. It's not accident that some people made it here today. And we ask, Lord, that you and your divine will speak to the many, to the multitude, to the hurt, to the pain, to disappointment in the lives of this congregation. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. The Bible begins and said, a certain man had two sons. This father had two sons. Son number one, the elder son, represented the Pharisees who judged others very harshly. They look to the outward deeds of people. They know all the father's rules, but didn't know the father's heart. Then son number two, the younger son, represented the publicans and the sinners, the bold-faced sinner. He didn't care about his privilege. He disdained his father's control and chose to enjoy the passive pleasures of this world with his friends. But even though different, they had one father. It amazes me how we classify each other. Black, white, Republican, Democrat, rich, poor. But today I declare we are all sons and daughters of the Father. God is the common Father to all mankind. We are all His offspring. We all have one Father. The oldest son represented the Pharisees. You see, the Jews murmured that this man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. They were angry that publicans and heathens could have the chance to repent and be encouraged to hope for pardon upon repentance. For they looked upon their case as desperate, these are the publicans and sinners, and thought that none but Jews had the privilege of repenting and being pardoned. They thought it a disparagement to Christ and inconsistent with the dignity of his character to make himself familiar with such sort of people, to admit them into his company and to eat with them. They had rejected Jesus, but now they were upset that others would have a chance to accept him. There are some people who are in the church today who are just like the Pharisees of old. They hedge up the way of salvation and make it hard for others to enter in. They look on the outward appearance and actions of people as if the heart can be measured by how long or how short a dress is, how much jewelry a person wears, or how much one does for God. This parable was attempting to show the Pharisees their true condition. They, like the other son, had snubbed their noses at those who they considered sinners. But I know we don't have that at this church. But in many churches across the nation, there are individuals who always been in the church. They've always been in the Father's house, but have never learned his character. Judas, who was a disciple of Jesus, was also a traitor. Jesus says of him in Psalms 41 verse 9, "Even my close friend whom I trusted, he who shared my bread, has lifted up his heel against me." Why is it that sometimes your worst enemy can be found at the church door? The people in the world can sometimes be nicer to you than your own brothers and sisters in the church. We have to be careful as children of God, because these publicans and sinners, those whom we may look down upon, who have checkered past, may just enter the kingdom before us. On the other hand, the younger son represented the bold, defiant sinner. The prodigal represents the class of unconverted sinners who are in desperate need of hearing the gospel of grace. But regardless of what camp you find yourself in, both are in need of the Savior. Both are in need of a name change. I kind of feel sorry for this father who had two sons, yet neither one of them knew about his love. How depressing it must still be for Jesus to see his church full of people who say they love him, yet hate each other. A church that worships in the truth, but don't have his spirit. But let's go to the scripture. Let's look at the word of God, verse 11. The Bible says, "And the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, do what? Give me the portion of goods that falleth to me.' And he divided unto him them his living." When the prodigal confronted his father, he did not politely ask, "Pray, give me," or, "Sir, if you please, give me," but he demanded, "Father, give me." The first thing that we need to understand is that inheritance was not given until someone was dead. The son did not care about whether his father was dead or alive. He just wanted what was his. He was the epitome of selfishness. But this man's sons were his life. These sons weren't just some property to him, like riches or furniture or goods. His estate represented all the riches of the gospel of grace. It was everything the father had planned for the life of his sons. There was an emotional connection between him and his sons. But the younger son didn't care. Verse 15 says, "And not many days after, the younger son gathered and took his journey into a what? Far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything." How did he know that the devil would give you enough much money to get you to hell, but he'll leave you high and dry when you're there so that you can't get out? This once treasured son is now pigging out. There are some things he said he would never do. Things that you thought that were once beneath you. But I submit to you today that when we go out into the far country, we many times come back with unnatural appetites that have been developed when hanging around with the pigs. This one favorite son now hires out himself to work. You see, a pig doesn't discriminate what it eats. You see, pigs weren't house pets. They were regarded as disgusting animals who harbored all kinds of diseases and still do. It does. So might I add, pigs are not to be eaten either. it eats whatever it wants and feasts on whatever it wants. But there are people who won't eat a pig. But there are people who will hang around pigs. There are people who are just like pigs. They put garbage in and all they get is garbage out. You know, there's a saying that says when you lie down with dogs, you get fleas. In Proverbs chapter 13, verse 20, it says it this way: walk with the wise and become wise. Associate with fools and get in trouble. What's interesting to me that the Bible declares in Luke chapter 15, verse 15, it says here, he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. How many of us know that this once favorite son, he started to eat with them? He started to drink with them. He partied with them, but he never was one of them. You can try to take off your holy inheritance. You can try to hang out with the boys, hang out with the fellas, and do everything that you're big and bad enough to do, but you have been marked with the stamp of Christ on your soul.
That's right.
God is trying to keep us out from the garbage with pigs. And what is it? What is it to want to eat what the pigs have eaten? Listen to what it says here. Testimonies for the Church, Volume 1, page 500. Listen here. Those who measure themselves by others do as others do and make no higher attainments, excusing themselves because of the faults and wrongs of others, are feeding on husk and will remain spiritual dwarfs as long as they gratify Satan by thus indulging their own unconsecrated feelings. I think you may have missed that. If I come into the church and say, well, Sister So-and-so's been in the church for 10, 15 years, and she's doing it, I should be okay. You are measuring yourselves by others, and you are reaching no higher than just because someone in the church is doing it longer than you've been a Christian doesn't give you the excuse to live your life the same way as well. These two sons had a mission. They weren't born orphans in the street without a moral compass. They were born in their father's house. These brothers had servants, and they each shared in the responsibility and privilege as the father's sons. I may be talking to someone today who knows what it means to be brought up as a Christian, even a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. You grew up singing songs from the hymnal. You know what it means. You know what it meant to talk to God in prayer and the beauty of worshiping God in spirit and in truth. The Sabbath school lesson and Pathfinders were where you found some of your earliest joys. But one day, you thought that your father's rules were too restrictive. You decided that he was cramping your style. So instead of being his child, you chose your freedoms in place of his restrictions. How many have left their homes to go into the far country where they spin up their God-given inheritance? How many homes who were looking to produce ministers have produced playboys, abusers, and absentee fathers? How many voices that would have advanced the kingdom of God when offered in humble submission to the divine will are now used to cause many to commit fornication, adultery, and excite sensual behavior? The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 59, verse 1 and 2, surely the arm of the Lord's hand is not too short to save, nor his ear too dull to hear. But your iniquities have separated you from your God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that he would not hear. God doesn't leave us. We leave him. We have gone to the far country. to cast off all restraint and indulge in our pleasures. But as sure as the promises of God, the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 57, 20, 21, it says what? But the wicked are like the troubled sea, when it cannot rest, whose waters cast up mire and dirt. There is no peace, says my God, for the wicked. The devil is ready to steal away your gifts. He wants to take your self-respect. He wants to take your name and make it a spectacle to all those who ever looked up to you. Then when it's all over and he's done the most damage with you in your life by hurting those who love you and using up what God gave you, then he'll kill you. Now the prodigal is alone in a far country. His friends, gone. Girlfriends, gone. Money, gone. Self-respect, gone. Then he suddenly begins to hear his stomach growl. He suddenly knows what it means to sleep on the streets. There's a famine in the land. But greater than his physical hunger is his spiritual one. Are you hungry this morning? There is a way out. Jesus says in John chapter 6, verse 35, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry. And he who believes in me will never be thirsty. Are you like the prodigal, hungering and thirsting for things that do not satisfy? Jesus says in John chapter 6, verse 54 to 56, whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. For my flesh is real food, and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in them. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me pure and clean again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Are you in a famine in the far country of your own choosing this morning? 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 14 to 16. This is what the Bible says. Listen to what Paul says to the young preacher Timothy. But I don't think that can just relate to Timothy. I think it also relates to us. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 14 through 16. The Bible says, listen. Do not neglect the spiritual gift within you, which was bestowed on you through prophetic utterance with the laying on of hands by the presbytery. Do not what? Neglect the spiritual gift within you. Verse 15, take pains with these things. Be absorbed in them so that your progress will be evident to all. Pay close attention to yourself and to your teaching. Persevere in these things, for as you do this, you will ensure both for yourself and for those, ensure salvation both for yourself and for those who hear you. There is a need for us as Christians to know ourselves. To know ourselves. Listen to what I'm going to say. I'm just going to get the action verbs. It says, do not neglect. Take pains. Be absorbed. Pay close attention. Persevere. Some of us take things that we should not take seriously, more seriously than we do taking pains to watch how we are developing in our Christian walk. As a Christian, we ought to know our strengths and our weaknesses. We ought to know the places that we dare not walk because we know our flesh is too weak. We ought to know the places where we do well and that we can use to grow in grace. So the Bible says, verse 17, but when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger. So now the son, he returns home. But how vast is the difference, the transformation from when he first left? He left self-confident, pockets full of money and full of ideas, strength and energy on what he would do first. He now comes back self-doubting, poor, hungry, and shamed. He says, I will arise and go to my father and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you and am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. Listen to this. Many, very important point here this morning. Many would not come to the service of Christ till they are brought to see themselves, until they are brought to see themselves just ready to perish in the service of sin. Mm-hmm. Let me back this up and say one more time. Take my time with it. Many would not come to the service of Christ till they are brought to see themselves just ready to perish in the service of sin. Until they reach that break. Let me say it this way. Many times as parents, we like to save our children from reaching rock bottom. We don't want them to reach rock bottom. Right before rock bottom comes, we jump in and save them. But look what it says. Many will not come to the service of Christ till they are brought to see themselves just ready to perish in the service of sin. Until they reach that breaking point, they will never know him as Lord and Savior. Stop saving your children from hitting rock bottom. Stop spoiling them. They may not get the education, but they end up with a lost soul because you babied them. Some of us never allow our children to reach this point. The father knew that the only way to really get his son back was to let him go. He had the power of choice. And parents, when you're dead, they're gonna do what they want to do anyway once you're dead. Once you're dead, they're gonna do whatever they want to do. So you might as well learn how to let them go now. He had the power of choice. But let me tell you, the father just didn't let him go. The father was praying for his son. Oh, my brothers and sisters, you got to learn how to let them go. Pray for them in the name of Jesus. To cover them in your prayers. But this is what the Bible says. So the scripture records. We're going to see what the father was doing. Verse 20. And the son said, he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, while he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion. Brothers and my sisters, you're always looking for your child to come back home. Just because you let them go doesn't mean you don't love them. Just because you let them go doesn't mean you're not praying for them. Just because you let them go doesn't mean you're not hoping that they return. The father was already looking in the direction of the far country when his son was headed home.
Wow.
How many times in church we're not looking in that direction? We're not looking for folks to come home. They out there, they ain't never coming back. They dismiss churches. We're not looking like the father looks, praying for them to come back home. They leave these doors and we talk about how we raised them right and they're gone and we wash our hands of them. This is not the heart of the Father. When he was still a great way off, before he could even step back in the doors of the church, his father saw him and had compassion. And ran. In that culture, men did not run. And ran. Fell on his neck. And kissed him. When he was yet a great way off, his father saw him before any of the other family were aware of it. God sees you. He sees the conviction in your heart. He sees your desire to serve him greater. Even though your family members can't see it. You know, they said, you said that, so many times. You're going to get your life right. They're tired of hearing it. But God sees it. His arms of mercy are stretched out to embrace his son. Though guilty, dirty, and newly come from feeding swine, the father drops on his neck and kisses him. This kiss not only assured his welcome, but sealed his pardon. Isaiah 54 verse 4 says it best. It says, fear not, for thou shalt not be ashamed. Neither be thou confounded, for thou shalt not be put to shame. For thou shalt forget the shame of thy youth, and shall not remember the reproach of thy widowhood anymore. God is not in the shaming business. The more we see of God's readiness to forgive others, to forgive us, the more we should be willing to forgive ourselves and even others. Jesus knows my background. He knows my strengths and my weaknesses. It was said of him, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Jesus not only knows your name, he not only knows your struggles, Jesus knows your neighborhood. Jesus was brought up in a low-rent, high-crime district. When faced with many temptations in his youth, Jesus responded with, it is written. Young companions urged him to do as they did. Jesus replied with the word, thy word I hid in my heart, that I may not sin against thee. Psalms 119. Often he was asked, why are you bent on being so singular, so different from us all? He replied with, it is written. When questioned why he did not join in the frolics of the youth of Nazareth, he said, it is written. Jesus was considered to be a goody tissue, a mama's boy, someone who was not willing to accept reality. But Jesus wasn't a mama's boy, he was his father's child. Amen. When you stand up for Jesus, you are now the aim of Satan's attacks. You will be called names, you will be made fun of, you will be looked down upon as being too serious, as not enjoying the pleasures of life, as missing out, as being too heavenly minded. But Paul tells Timothy in 2 Timothy, he says, flee also youthful lust, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Everyone has a struggle in life to deal with. Everyone. The prodigal son had his pride, and he thought his way was better than God's way. Some have other struggles. But no matter your symptoms, there is an underlying solution to the trouble you are experiencing. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13 says, there have no temptation taken you, but such as is what? Common to man. There have no temptation taken you, but such as is what? Common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape it, that ye may be able to bear it. Whatever your personal struggle this morning, God knows it. You are not alone. It is common to humanity. You're not alone. There is power over any temptation, any sin that you may be experiencing. You see, in the book of Hebrews, which book did I say? The book of Hebrews, there is the hall of faith. These are the stars of faith. If you look in this book, you see there's Moses. And the Bible says, by faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. In this hall of faith, you will see Abraham, who says by faith, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son. Here, you will also see Isaac, the son of Abraham. And it says of Isaac, by faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau concerning things to come. Then on to Jacob. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed both the sons of Joseph and worshiped leaning upon the top of the staff. But you may have a problem. Because someone may say this is not the whole story. Moses had an anger problem and killed an Egyptian. But it's not listed there. Isaac showed Abraham, lied and found another way to bring the promised son. But it's not listed there. Jacob was a deceiver. But it's not listed there. And much more can be said about the rest. But why are these acts mentioned here? Because by their faith in Jesus, what we see is only their good because Jesus has covered all of their bad. To those of you who are concerned with your past, when folks see you walking back in the doors of the church, when they remember you for what you have done back in the past, let me show you, let me tell you today that in the eyes of Christ, your past is hidden in him. Can I get an amen? Amen. He covers all my wrong and gives me a new start. You see liar, God sees forgiven. You see fornicator, God sees forgiven. You see drunkard, God sees forgiven. Satan is the accuser of the brethren. But thanks be to God for Jesus. Thanks be to God for Jesus. Because Revelation chapter 3, verse 14 says to the angel of the church in Laodicea, listen to what the Bible says. Write, these are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. See, I may have a bad report out about me, but I've got a faithful and true witness up in heaven, the eternal God in heaven. I don't care what you may say about me down here, but I got a father up there who sits up high and looks down low and says, there goes my child. And though you may remember him as once this way, he has been hidden in me.
Amen.
He's my son. He's my child. And I don't care what he's done in the past. That's why the Father kissed him, embraced him, looked a far way off, waiting for him. That was the Father's response. There's one great witness out of all those witnesses who has the power to cover me in all my unrighteousness. He knows your name this morning. He knows your environment. He knows the strengths and weaknesses you had to endure. You were raised in a certain environment that make you more prone to certain temptations. He knows. Not so perfect home. He knows. You got an appetite that has been developed out in the far country that you don't know how to deal with, developed over time, and now you wonder you could ever get the victory over it? He knows. You got something that you're struggling with this morning? He knows. The Father says, let us all eat and be merry, for it is a good day. For this my son was dead, but his return is as life from the dead. He is alive again. We thought that he was dead, haven't heard nothing from him of a long time, but behold, he lives. He was lost. We gave him up for lost. We despaired of hearing of him, but he is found. The joy that God has over his lost children. Coming home, we should all have. Because the same amount of power it takes to raise one from the dead, physical death, it's the same amount of power it takes to raise a spiritual life that's dead and to quicken it, to make it alive unto salvation. That's why Jesus died. That's why the power is in the cross. The power was in his death. It was his sacrifice that gave us power to live. Before we make our appeal, we're going to ask the follower. She's going to sing. She's going to give us a word. And we're going to call. We're going to call for God's children. We're going to call for prodigals. We're going to call for sons and daughters.
Okay. Good to see you, man. All right.
To come back home with Jesus. To make a commitment to come home with Jesus.
Shell.
right. We shall behold him. I want to make two appeals. First appeal. You got an appetite. You got a situation that's controlling you that you cannot control. You're out in a far country and you need some help today. You want to say, Lord, I need a divine encounter with you today. I need help. I need victory. I got some things I'm dealing with in my life, and unless you come down and draw close to me, I'm not going to be an overcomer. Who are you? That's what I want you to stand and let you pray. You got some specific things I want you to stand. That's just the first appeal. The second appeal. I don't want to be by myself. There's somebody here who needs to come home to Jesus. Somebody here this morning wants to come back home. You feel like a prodigal. You've been away from the Father's house. You've been away from his heart, from his love. I don't know where you are, but I'm calling you to come forward. Where are you this morning? Where are you? Anyone wants to say, Lord Jesus, I want to come home. I want to give my life to you totally, Jesus. I want to completely surrender my life to you. I want to stop living life the way I used to live. I want to have a new life in Christ. Where are you this morning? I want to invite you down to the front for complete, total surrender. The Bible says, we shall behold him. And when he comes, the church is coming for ready people. He's not coming for folk to get ready. He's coming for folk who have been made ready by his blood. God bless you, my brother. God bless you, my brother. But I believe that somebody needs to come home. Somebody else needs to come home. You're fighting with surrendering your life to Jesus. But let me tell you, the Father will receive you with open arms. He will wrap his arms of love around you, kiss you, embrace you, and let you know that you are his son, that you are his daughter. I want to pray for you. I want to come down to the front. Where are you? I want to pray for you. God bless you.
Savior,
I. Oh, well, come on now. I believe there's about two more. There's about two more that needs to come down. You need to give it to Jesus. Give it your life to Him. Come on now, where are you?
To achieve,
why are you?
I surrender
all to Him. I freely give
to Him.
I will ever love and trust Him. Sing it out, congregation. Sing it out. They're in a mind warfare right now. The battle is in the mind. We need you to pray. Our heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Let's pray. Let's be praying for those who need to make a decision for Jesus. We invite you to the front. We thank you for being our Lord and Savior this morning. Lord, you're not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That is your prayer. You're not willing that any should perish. But Father, we do have decisions. We have choices to make. And Lord, you would not force yourself upon us. But Lord, we ask that you do give us trouble. We have come in this house knowing that we should surrender, but we have not surrendered. Give us trouble. You said in your word, the wicked are like the troubled seed. They find no rest. And today we're asking for no rest for these hearts that are in the valley of decision. May they realize life without Christ is no life. May they know that the abundant life should be the only life that they should endeavor to have. But Father, we thank you for those who've come up to the front, young and old, to say, Lord, no longer life on my own, but a life with Jesus. We thank you. We praise you. We glorify you. We magnify you. We honor you. We exalt you. We praise you. We worship you. Lord, we thank you. For it's in the matchless name of your Son, Jesus, that all God's children say, amen and amen.
You're the center of my joy. my head.